In the last few months, we got used to getting great chapters. One after the other, each chapter offered some unique look into our characters, while introducing us to amazing scenes as we go closer to the final moments of our story. But none of those fantastic chapters even came close to the latest one, which, in my opinion, was one of the best in the entire story. The sheer magnitude of the events of this chapter left me speechless in some parts, and I'm sure it did the same to a lot of you as well. This chapter had a grand show of emotions. Death, love, amazing panels and endless symbolism, and I'm going to mention a lot of them in today's video, and maybe even surprise some of you. We will also take a closer look at Eren, Annie, Armin, and every little thing that you might have overlooked. So don't forget to smash that subscribe button if you are new here, and please keep in mind that we are going to talk about recent events in the manga, and there will be spoilers. And with that, let's start analyzing our latest chapter. Welcome to the Rumbling. The chapter starts with our little immigrant kid and his brother stashing the money they stole in the ground at the base of a tree. The immigrant boy is missing his hand, and his younger brother tells him that he is afraid they will get caught stealing again. Right from the start, we can see a clear connotation between them and Eren and Armin. While Eren and Armin dreamt about freedom from the walls, those two brothers dream and fight for freedom from a miserable social and economical life. And the little money they have is the symbol of freedom for them. The boys' names are Turkish and Arabic in origin, and also here we have symbolism. The young boy's name is pronounced Khalil. The name Khalil means honorable comrade, or the honorable one. And as we can see, he is more worried for his brother and grandfather and not for himself. The older boy's name is pronounced Ramzi, and he is the boy that we saw in Eren's memories. But the symbolism for his name we will reveal in a few more minutes. From the few opening panels, we get a very ominous vibe with panels full of crows flying around. A crow is a bird that is known for her connotation to death and is often considered as an omen for bad things that are about to come. When a group of crows gather around in one place, it usually signifies death. And another fun fact, when a group of crows flies together, we call them a murder of crows, which is very fitting to what is about to come in this chapter. Next, we see the entire camp running away, what shows us for a fact that these people are not a part of the subjects of Ymir, because they didn't hear Eren's message. Apparently, the Marleyans ran away without even thinking about them. That shows us the clear difference in social classes, just like we used to see between the people of Maria, Rose and Sina inside the walls. Khalil is using a beautiful phrase, "the ground is crying," to describe the rumbling of the upcoming titans. We can also find the symbolism from the Bible here, referring to God, mentioning the earth is crying because of all the blood that has been spilled on it by humans. We see the two boys look at all the crows in the sky as we dive into Eren's memory and a flashback of the first time they visited Marley. Here we get a clear look of Eren's thoughts while his friends ate ice cream and had fun at a carnival. Now we can understand why he acted the way he did on that day. While walking among all those people, he already knew he was going to kill them at some point in the future. And seeing all of them as he saw in his memories just showed him that nothing changed and this future is about to become reality. As he walks on the streets, he understands that they didn't find a way to save the island, and that at some point he is going to demolish all those people around him and many more. He thinks about what his mother would have think of him now. And finally, we see Eren admitting to himself and to us readers that letting all the people of the island die like the first king intended might actually be the more reasonable solution, simply because fewer people will be killed. But he quickly reverts and says that he cannot accept it. And pay attention to his eyes. Like the eyes of the previous holders of the Founding Titan affected by the vow, only here, Eren is choosing to not accept the king's wish. And without royal blood, he can actually do it. But we can also see him change entirely from looking sad and bored, and we see the anguish on his face. Eren's internal conflict is serious. and we will explore it as we move on. Aaron keeps walking until he notices Ramsey, the boy he saw in his future memory. Here, we have another interesting moment, as Aaron thinks about saving Ramsey from the people attacking him, but he has an inner conflict, thinking how can he even try to act honorably if he knows what horrible things he himself is about to do in the future. He decides to turn around, but soon backtracks and saves him from the attackers. And he finishes with, "The future never changes." But we have to ask ourselves, what made Aaron save him eventually? Was it because he simply wanted to help? Or maybe because he couldn't accept the violence right in front of him? Or maybe, and this is a tricky one, was it because he saw the boy in his future memories and knew he didn't die in this alley? Ask yourself, did knowing that fact somehow affected the way Aaron acted? Think about that for a while, because personally, these kinds of things can drive me insane. Here is where the chapter goes into high emotional gear as Aaron faces Ramsey and finally asks for forgiveness for everything he wished in the past and for everything he is about to do in the future. And if you are confused like Ramsey here, this is because Aaron is not actually talking to him. Aaron is talking to humanity, to everyone that he is going to hurt. This moment symbolizes Aaron's anguished soul and true feelings of remorse, and Ramsey symbolizes the world. And Aaron saying this to him is also the perfect symbolism, because the meaning of the name Ramsey in Arabic is literally the word symbolic. You see why I wanted to wait with this one. It's more fun like this. Going back to Ramsey and Aaron, we see Aaron crying and apologizing to young Ramsey as we switch to the scenes of Ramsey and Khalil escape from the camp as they see they are surrounded by colossal titans from all directions. I can't wait to see this one gets animated. A titan with no eyes? Oh my god, that is terrifying. Khalil asks Ramsey if they are going to get trampled, and Ramsey tells him that they cannot give up. We jump to Aaron as he confesses that saving the island wasn't his only motivation. I also mentioned a few months back that Aaron came to see that boy before the scouts spent time there, and this is that exact moment and memory. The two boys run with the crowd as Khalil drops their sack of money, which symbolizes their freedom from poverty. In the background, Aaron confesses, "What was beyond the walls was not what I dreamt of. It wasn't like the world I saw as a child in Armin's book." We see the two brothers chased by the colossal titans as the buildings around them collapse on top of them, killing Khalil in a horrible way. He died holding what's left of their money, like dying, holding the last piece of their freedom. We can also see Ymir looking from the side. This scene was a bit weird, especially because Ymir is drawn like she is fading, so I'm not really sure she's actually there, but please, tell me what you think about this one. And finally, as a titan is about to step on Ramsey, we get the most powerful scene here, at least for me, when Aaron finally admits that when he learned humanity lived beyond the walls, he was disappointed. And that is also the moment I cried. And yes, I am serious. This scene was so intense on so many levels, and I cannot even imagine how it would look like animated. But not only because of all of the destruction, but mainly because of Aaron, because at that exact moment, I absolutely understood how he felt. Freedom was supposed to be his prize. That is what was promised to him as a child. You go beyond the walls, beyond the titans, and you get freedom. A world just for young Aaron and his friend to explore and do whatever they wanted. He never considered there will be people out there. And why should he? For him, the world outside was full of titans, and once he defeats them all, he will get his prize. Freedom. A world for him to explore. But when he realized this is not the case, that broke his heart, and he wished for that world to go away. Now, was it a selfish wish? Well, yes, on some level, but also somewhat understandable. Imagine yourself in this situation, and the amount of depression this can make you feel. Not to mention all the memories that come with it, and together they are creating a huge conflict inside Aaron. Eren admits to Ramsay that he wished it all just go away and keeps on crying that he is sorry, and then we see Ramsay being crushed horribly in a way that reminds me of how Bertel died, leaving behind a giant footprint with two boys crushed on the ground. We see destruction all around and a group of people trying to pass a locked gate, very similar to the gates being closed when the Armored Titan charged the gates. We then see the aftermath of the Titan March, and ironically enough, the only thing left standing is that little wall, with the gate now open, to signify that there was never any hope of escaping. Ever since I was born, there, before my eyes, stood those miserable walls. We hear Eren as we switch between his monster Titan to him and Armin, to the moment Armin told him about the outside world and sparked this dream inside of young Eren. This is actually a very important point, and we will touch on that very soon. In the background of young Eren imagining how free it would make someone to witness the outside world, we see the total destruction on Marley, as we get to probably the best panel of young Eren. As people getting crushed on Marley, young Eren turns playfully to Armin, asking him if this is that sight. A few things here. Take notice that young Eren's view is actually Eren's Titan among the clouds of steam. Although I personally believed the sight would be something else, it did offer an explanation for why Grisha was scared of it while Eren wasn't. And again, like everything in Attack on Titan, it was because of a different point of view. Because as Eren witnessed what young Eren was seeing, Grisha witnessed the actual destruction. Second thing, this scene can finally bring some context to the visuals of Season 3 Part 1 OP, as we see young Eren running around while older Eren is only looking at a distance. And the last thing is Eren asking Armin about the sight, which can signify that Armin knows about it, talked to Eren about it, or even was the one that told Eren about it. So again, we see Armin in play here, and don't worry, we are going to talk about him in a few minutes. The next panel shows us young Eren looking playful and smiling to older Armin. Armin calls him by his name, and suddenly finds himself on the boat. Although, if you ask me, they did have a talk that we haven't got to see. This panel confused a lot of people, and I can see why, because you can interpret it in a few different ways. You need to understand that Armin didn't transport all of a sudden to another place. This is all happening at the same time. Nothing freezes and no one is being transported. The paths transcend time and space. And as I explained in several of my videos, according to physics theories, time is actually an illusion. It is not a straight line and everything is actually happening at the same time, past, present and future, all depending on your point of view in space-time. And yes, according to quantum physics, an object can, in fact, be in two places at the same time. And I will gladly explain this further if you want, but on another video. So, without getting into too much science, and if you still want to visualize it, just think of time as an infinite loop, so big that you can't even see it all, and also, you can't tell where is the beginning and where is the end. This is one way to imagine time. So why is Armin here? Well, because young Eren summoned his best friend. And why is younger Eren in the paths now? Because I believe that he is in control right now, or more precisely, the wish and will of young Eren. While not aware of the destruction he is causing, he is just pushing forward into the sight he wished to see since he was a kid, not even knowing what kind of power he has. And it seems that whoever in the paths is the one in control. Just like Ymir took the shape of a younger girl because those emotions she had since she was a child is what drove her to believe she was a slave. Going back to our chapter, Armin snaps out from this moment with Eren. He is fully healed by now and finds himself with Annie. Here we have Annie thanking Armin for all the years he talked to her while she was frozen. We can clearly see how grateful she is, but she is also confused. Why would Armin choose to talk to her and spend time with her? Even after he tells her that he did it because he wanted to, she still asks why. Annie simply got to a point that she hates herself so much that she can't even imagine how someone can want her around or care for her. Just think about all those years she was like that, unable to move or speak. This probably has been a nightmare, and Armin and Hitch were the ones that saved her from losing her mind. Armin is surprised that she doesn't get it. And yes, I can absolutely see feeling from Armin towards her. And no, it is not because of Bertolt, at least in my opinion. Well, I mean sure, it doesn't hurt to have Bert inside your head, but the truth is that Armin always had a soft spot for Annie, ever since they met. And like I once mentioned, she didn't try to kill him as the female Titan, although she killed almost everyone else around. So yes, I do believe this is Armin stepping up a bit and showing his true feeling for her. Annie tells Armin that the only reason he did that is because he is a good person, which is also the reason why he won't give up talking to Eren. He just wants to avoid conflict. But as soon as she tries to get up, Armin grabs her hand and explains that after all the things he did, the friends he betrayed and the people he killed, he doesn't like to be called a good person anymore. In his eyes, he has been a monster for a long time now. He tells Annie about the promise he made to Eren, and how it wasn't the world they dreamed of. Pay attention that this is the same as Eren said to Ramsay in this chapter. We see a seagull lands next to Armin. At this point, I won't rule out the possibility that Eren sent this bird somehow to communicate with his best friend. And that is beautiful, because seagulls are a symbol for freedom. So this seagull is literally the wings of freedom. The last panel, we get Armin saying he still wants to believe there is a world they don't know about beyond the walls, as we see Eren sleeping in his Titan. Notice that he is in the same state as he was when he lifted the giant boulder in season 1, and also when he was knocked into the wall of Shiganshina by Bertolt. Also, pay attention to the extensions that come out from his head and probably his brain. This is the first time we're seeing something like this, because humans are usually connected to the Titan's flesh by the nape and from the limbs, but not from the head as far as we know. And that is where our amazing chapter ends. So what's going to happen next? And did Mikasa also get a seagull from Eren? But now seriously, currently, we have Titan Eren, which is clearly controlled by his younger self ideal of freedom. So can he really be stopped? I will raise something that will probably is going to upset some people, but I think we might even get some Armin twist soon. If you noticed, Armin has been slowly declining in the past chapters. He is not the same Armin we knew. In this chapter, we've seen him mentioned by Eren a few times, and we see that the strong connection of their mutual promise is still strong in both of them. Armin was always a logical, reasonable type. He knows that what happened cannot be changed. So I think there is a possible chance we see Armin siding with Eren to somehow get to fulfill their dream. Armin already thinks of himself as a monster. He knows he is beyond redemption, so now he can sit and cry about all the things he did. Or he should keep moving forward. But what do you think about that? Do you see Armin going with Eren? And do you think Armin incepted the idea of freedom into Eren, like in Inception? Also, tell me what you think about this chapter. And of course, don't forget to subscribe, because I'm doing a follow-up video for this one, where we will talk about the first king, Karl Fritz, about the definition of freedom, and also try to find out if Eren is truly free, or was, in fact, a slave all along. All that and more in my future video, and I will see you all real soon. And until then, don't forget to dedicate your hearts for humanity, inside and outside the walls.